do you consider the, a lower cost equivalent of what was the Prodigy of the Rogue to complement the Voyager range?
Yeah, we've considered a lot of things. Among them, a simpler, lower cost, basic monophonic instrument with basic features. It's not something that that we're developing right now. Our product development schedule is full right now, but it's something that we may do in the near future. When I say may do, I don't mean to create a mystery of this.
No.
There are always more products than we have time to do. We do one or two at a time. And at any one time, there seem to be more reasons to do one than to do the other. We have to wait until that time before we know. So we haven't decided yet, but that's certainly one possibility. We would introduce a lower cost, simpler, monophonic instrument of some sort.
Do you think you're more market driven, or are you trying to set a standard in the market with the product?
We're not market driven in the sense that we sent our market research people, we sent a market research team out to tell us what to do. I have ideas for what would make good instruments. Some of the ideas are very closely in line with what's selling today, and some ideas are not. Ones that are not, I think they're good ideas because once people see them, they may understand more what they think for and make more sense. We're market-driven in that we have to be concerned with what people will pay for instruments that we build. We had no trouble at all building a dream synthesizer that does everything, or not does everything, but does more than this, or does this, but has 32 voices or 64 voices. That's no problem at all.
And I guess leading on from that is also the Taurus 1 bass pedals. I'm sure you've never been asked that question. I have such a lot of interest in supplying this. I mean, the list is almost endless, and there's very few in the world, certainly in working condition anyway. Please bring it back.
Okay, first of all, I would like to understand, I'll interview you,
please.
I'll ask you a question. Is it the sound of the instrument, or the fact that it's, the fact that it's a solid pedal board with nice big buttons to push with your feet? Now, what's important about the Taurus?
I think there's two things, fundamentally. The first thing is, it's a unit a guitarist can use.
Mm-hmm.
So they can have bigger presence on stage.
Yeah.
And introduce new tonal qualities to sound. Obviously, there's a historical interest because big bands like Genesis and Rush they used to use them, but as a unit, it's very useful for keyboardists and guitarists, so it has a dual purpose. And the second, most importantly, is yes, it's the sound. It has, it was designed primarily to do what it did. I think the interface was very easy, very robust, and even today stands up very well.
Mm-hmm.
But the sound was uniquely tailored to doing the job it did. And, if you look at compared to the Voyager, it's very limited, in terms of potential. But actually, that's not necessarily the issue. It's just getting that absolutely humongous, enormous bass sound coming out on stage. And the people that are buying them now are people for live use. It's live bands using on stage. It's not for home and glass case in the studio. It's very much a current product that people are using.
The reason I'm interested in differentiating between the package aspect of it and the sound aspect is that the package is inherently expensive. There are very few places in the world now where you can go and buy a pedal board mechanism like that. We can't make them because it just takes far too much tooling to produce the number of Tauruses. So we have to use somebody else's tooling, which means we have to go to keyboard mechanism manufacturer, and there are very few in the world. And because there are very few, and we're a small company, they're a problem. We're a problem for them, and they're a problem for us. And that's not a comfortable position to be in. So I'm trying to understand if a manual keyboard rather than a pedal board would be acceptable, and you're saying no. I mean, you can't play up here if you're also playing guitar.
Absolutely, and if you have a pedal board, you can play a keyboard and pedals. So it's aimed at the performing musician, as opposed to the again the home professional. Okay.
So you're saying it has to have pedals.
That's what I'm told.
Yeah. Okay. Now here's a question for you. Standard home organ, little home organ keyboard, pedal board, goes from C to C. Guitars and basses don't go from C to C, they start at E. How much better would it be if we could get a pedal mechanism that started with E?
I think for guitarists it would be fundamental.
Yeah, but for keyboards they would probably prefer it in C.
C, yeah.
Okay.
So both, the answer is yes to both.
How about an octave and a half?
Perfect compromise, I guess, yeah.
How many do you have on your list waiting?
Any one time?
Yeah.
15. Mm-hmm. Globally, all over the world. Yeah. And that's people who will buy now. There's always another 50.
What sort of price are you?
Well, the original Moog, the Taurus 1s, about £2,000 UK. So
a restored?
Restored.
Original version.
So $3,500.
That's about five times as much as the cost in back then.
This is what's happening. At any one time in the world, there may be one available once every 6 months. Do you remember how many of those are actually made?
Yeah.
Very few around.
A big distinction is made between the Taurus 1 and Taurus 2. Do you find that too?
Absolutely.
Taurus 1 is better sell?
Absolutely. Yeah. Taurus 2s will sell, give you an idea, will sell for about £500.
Yeah.
Generally nobody buys them.
Is it because of the sound or because of the fact that it's...
I think the sound is different and people recognize it as a different sound,
yeah.
And the design is less interesting. So as a package, the Taurus 1, like the original Mini Moog, was just right.
Yeah.
With some of my customers buying vintage analog equipment, why do you think, in your opinion, has this interest in vintage equipment come back for today's home professional studios? Why is there such a resurgence of interest?
It's a question that's asked so frequently. I could be flip and say, oh, it's just fashion. I have a sense it's a lot more than that. I have the sense that now that musicians have a lot of experience with digital instruments, in particular, have bumped up against the limitation of digital instruments when it comes to getting really great sound or getting their hands in there and shaping the sound. These very basic advantages of analog stuff are becoming clearer. In the early 80s, mid-80s, they weren't there. People they were enamored with the novelty of all this digital stuff. The DX7, be able to get a polyphonic synthesizer with all these new sounds for $2,000 in the United States. That was a very distracting thing. And then the sample playing instruments, the Emu stuff, and then the Kurzweil stuff, and all the, you know, the long string of digital stuff that Roland and Korg and Yamaha came out with. You know, there was a certain amount of excitement because it was so new, but that, you know, that's died down now. The musicians are missing this, really, this sense of being able to connect with the sound. I think it's much more difficult to do that in a digital instrument. There is a tactile nature, that's a part of it, but there's also a uniquely human thing that goes on. That has to do with more than just how it feels or what the harmonics are.
It's interesting because, of course, the new Korg product, the Legacy, which you see, is perhaps the compromise. Maybe that's the technological compromise between virtual analog and virtual technology and the hardware interface. Would that be a possible route that you think Moog would go into?
Anything's possible. At this point, we don't have plans to go that route. It's just very hard to know what we're going to do in the future with so many variables.
If you were to go back in time, I'm sure you get asked to do that a lot, and without any worries of commercial reasoning, what product would you have designed that you haven't?
It's hard for me to think of you know, what I would do if there weren't commercial reasons. You know, I'm an engineer, and engineers, I have a fairly classical engineering training. Classically, an engineer does things the most cost-effective way. We're always having to worry about what things cost. In fact, when I began engineering school, the first day, the dean of students, the first group of new engineering students, and he said, "Let me tell you guys, you're all guys, one girl, but let me tell you guys what an engineer is. An engineer is somebody who can do for 2 cents what any damn fool can do for 3 cents." So, you know, I've always thought of myself, I've always thought of part of my job is being very concerned about what it costs so that people want to pay more than necessary for what we build. I really can't imagine building something without thinking about what it's going to cost.
Philosophically difficult to do then.
Yeah, I mean, if somebody said to me today, you know, you don't have to worry about anything else, all the engineering responsibilities you take care of on a day-to-day basis could be taken care of by somebody else, go off and, you know, design something. I would probably design something very inexpensive, but it would be very good for what it cost. I'm picking up good
vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. Because you still produce the theremin.
Yeah.
Which is interesting, because although it's within the kind of genre of synthesis, it's kind of different products. I know historically that's the beginning for it, isn't it?
Yeah.
Why are you still involved in that?
Well, it's a very interesting user interface, and by this time I know quite a bit of how to design and build theremins, and a lot of musicians want them. We've made about 10,000 theremins in the last 6 years. Yeah,
it's incredible. What kind of people are buying them?
All kinds. You know, rockers are buying them, jazz musicians, classical musicians, people who want to have fun at parties, people who want to play religious music. Just everybody I know plays the theremin serious has a different view of what the instrument is good for.
Well, I mean, obviously as an engineer, you must enjoy challenging the convention of music technology design.
Yeah.
I think that's probably what you recognize more than anything else. The original Stepladder filter is certainly recognised as the most famous and the most copied. And I think certainly the Holy Grail in terms of the songs. So had you ever considered designing a different filter that would equal that in character but deliver something quite distinctively different? Is it impossible?
Oh no, it's not impossible. We've experimented with different filter configuration. And in fact, with the new MRF, the multiple resonance filter, is going to be something that people haven't heard. It's not the design of an individual filter, but the way the filters are arranged that give it its character.
It sounds more like a modular in nature in terms of the character of it.
Yeah.
I don't know whether you've been asked this question, I'm sure you have done, Rob, but I get asked this a lot, is your involvement with analog synthesis and synthesizers over the last 40, 50 years. Is it safe to assume that you must have played just about every possible vintage synthesizer, including obviously your own, over that period?
No, I played a few, but my day-to-day activities don't usually include evaluating or reverse engineering other people's instruments.
No, but you're just having access to people's studios, and you may have seen equipment for the last 2-3 decades that you've played.
It may be a surprise, but I'm not that familiar with other people's instruments.
Because the question was to lead on to, what would have been your favourite synthesizer over that time? Which is, I guess, it's a hard question. Is it a Moog?
I think so. You know, and the modular instruments were nice for one reason, and the original Mini Moog was nice for another. This Mini Moog point, I think, you know, if I could take one instrument to desert island, it would be these four instruments.
The very early RA Moog Mini Moogs were, without doubt, the most popular ones I could find in sound. They have a very unique character in sound. It sounds so much different to the ones that were 3 or 4 years later. And I guess that's because the design improved and maybe they got more stable, whatever the various reasons are. But had you ever considered producing or making a synthesizer that's designed in the diversity to produce that character? It's a kind of ironic question, but it's just from what I see from the equipment I see now, that's people actually say that I want it a little bit unstable, and you know, I want that sound because it doesn't track right.
We have that. It's an interesting idea, but we haven't.
The last question I have for you is a bit tongue-in-cheek, but you're involved with music, musicians over so many years. Have you ever performed and recorded your own music?
No. I've made guest appearances, from time to time. They haven't amounted to much music. I'm not a musician. I'm a tool maker. I like working with musicians. And it's just fine with me if the musicians are the ones who make the music.
Do you still keep in touch with people like Keith Anderson and Greg Lane, as you mentioned earlier?
We manage to keep in touch. We see each other at shows. I help Keith with a couple of things, and with a couple of things.
Because he's been out touring this last year, isn't he?
Yeah. Well, they're playing at the Moog Fest on the 18th.
Uh-huh.
Keith and Rick are playing.
Yeah.
Now they're both in the same bill.